Resilience isn't a suit of armor, it's a muscle. It can be flexed, it can be increased. You learn it best in times of struggle, and you learn it by grounding yourself in the moment when things go wrong and then managing how you ruminate on those events.
Any other kind of outside influence, unwelcome criticism, unsolicited advice, mansplaining, you saying something in a meeting and afterwards someone rephrases it and gets all the credit. Maybe it's just the sort of person who, when you say any questions, they say, well, actually, it's more of a comment. Those kind of people, right? Let's call them, and then we'll be Q&A later, so don't. Let's call those hecklers. Now, when dealing with hecklers, as a comedian, there's a couple of golden rules that I've sort of synthesized from over these many years of interviews and personal experience. The first is not to assume it's an attack. It is so easy when someone delivers a piece of criticism in whatever form to assume that you are being attacked, to assume that criticism is actually what's going on. Look at us now, 180 people in the room, me on stage, we're all just monkeys watching a monkey, right? We're all just animals, and I sit here and I stand here and I see all your faces looking at me, all those pair of eyes. It's a weird experience. Look at this, is it hostility? All it would take is someone to get up and leave, check a text, yawn. Suddenly my internal narrative is like, this is all about me, I can't cope. They're negative, they hate me, they're not interested. And I start writing that own little narrative to myself. It's so easy to do. I'll give you an example. I spoke to Sarah Millican, fabulous Sarah Millican, British comic, does huge, huge venues on her tours. And I said, you're so famous now that you must know everyone in the audience is a fan. She says, no, far from it. I'm so famous that I know half of the audience have been brought by a fan. So I said, oh, that's a good point. I hadn't thought about it like that. What do you do when you see someone not enjoying yourself? And she said, and this is a direct quote, she said, when I see someone not smiling, I just assume they've got teeth. Some people don't like their smile. That's fair enough. Some people are self-conscious about their face. Some people sit there watching you with what could charitably be described as resting difficult face. They just have that face, right? And it's always them that walk up to you afterwards and go, that was the funniest thing I've ever seen in my entire life. And you think, well, thanks, now I know. My job is such that if I look on YouTube, my peers, often people who started later on than me, will be there with a majillion hits doing, you know, Netflix specials left, right and centre. If I walk out the front door, a bus will go past with my mate's face on it. And the way I deal with that, rather than spinning off into this kind of internal cataclysm of, oh God, well, they're doing so well, I highly recommend get in touch with them. Contact the person, say, well done, God, I'm jealous. I can't believe you won that. I can't believe you did that. God, that's brilliant. And you'll get a story back from them. It's meaningful to me because my dad was connected to that charity, or I've been trying to get this project away for 20 years. I didn't think it would happen. And you go, oh yeah, you're a real person. And actually I'm telling myself a story about what it means. With that in mind, I'm going to split what I talk about into two things chronologically. I'm going to talk about what I call the sharp end and the blunt end of resilience. The sharp end is there and then, in the moment when it's all going wrong. You're on stage, you're crashing and burning, everyone hates you. It's the piercing moment of the crisis. Oh my God, how can I cope with this? That's the sharp end. The blunt end of resilience is a bit longer than that. It's a bit more insidious. The blunt end is after the gig, when things have gone horribly wrong and you're sitting there alone in your car, clubbing yourself over the head with that negative self-talk. What Felicity Ward, brilliant Australian comic, she calls Old Faithful. An Old Faithful is that old baseball bat that you keep somewhere, a metaphorical one, on which you have engraved those deep, negative, core self-beliefs that you'd never dream of telling another person. They're different for everybody. Maybe it's, my parents always preferred my sibling. Bong. You know, maybe it's, if I don't make enough money, I'll be a loser and no one will love me. Clang. Those sorts of things that you batter yourself over the head with. The particular attack, the line of attack that you reach for when you're feeling really down.